Hi, I'm Ben Mankiewicz, host of The Plot Thickens and Turner Classic Movies. We wanted to bring you some of our favorite moments from Peter Bogdanovich's archive. If you've been listening to The Plot Thickens, you know that Peter started recording interviews with some of classic Hollywood's greatest directors in the early 1960s. These are really the conversations where Peter learned his craft, learned how to be a movie director. We hope you enjoy it.
So can I have more tea? That looks awful pale.
Why don't you give him mine?
You like it as pale as that?
I don't really care.
Well, I can certainly make more. I have more.
Does mine look better to you?
Yeah, now put some more tea. You can have some milk. Put some more tea in that one.
Somebody told me you hate eggs.
Never eaten an egg in my life. Never touched one.
Why is that?
I don't know.
Well, I noticed that in Jesse Rose.
Yes, I took it out on a couple of eggs. Joe Cotton in Shadow of a Doubt. Cutting through the yolk of an egg, of a fried egg, at a dramatic moment.
Oh, yes, yes, that's right.
That one.
Can't bear them, can you?
No.
That's why the hard-boiled egg in the in Spellbound.
Oh, yes, yeah, sure. That's all part of it.
Yeah. Do you remember... this is a long question. Do you remember where you appear in all your films, and how did you first get the idea to do that?
Down in the lodger, in a print, in a newspaper office scene. I'm seen seated in the foreground at a desk. And that was done because we just, in a scene of that kind, we didn't even bother to engage actors, you know. So all right, boys, all sit down in the newspaper office, you know.
And so you decided from then on to appear in all of them?
Yeah.
And have you appeared in all since then?
Nearly all, yes. I can't remember the ones I haven't, but the first big one was Blackmail.
Where you're in the subway.
In the subway.
That's and the first. Child.
That, it really started with Blackmail, I would say.
Really?
Since Talking Pictures. Not many in the silent pictures.
In Chabrol's book, he tells a story about you being put in jail at an early age by your father or whatever, and he seems to think it's very significant to your whole development. Do you think so? Do you think it has any particular significance?
It could be. The actual occasion was when I suppose I must have been at the age of five when I was sent along with a note to the chief of police, who read the note, then promptly put me into a cell and locked the door.
And you hadn't read the note?
For 5 minutes. No, I hadn't read the note. And...
For 5 minutes?
Yes, and then said, that's what we do to naughty little boys, you see. Now, what effect that had on me at the time, I can't remember. But, they always say, psychiatrically, if you can discover the origins of this or that, it releases everything. I don't think it released me from a natural fear of police.
Yeah, which you always had. But you chronicled that kind of feeling of a person being, in the wrong man.
Oh, I felt the front part of the wrong man, I felt very much.
Yeah.
I was very aware. Not so latterly. I've often thought of a scene of a man, especially in the English sense, being taken to jail in what they used to call the Black Mariah.
Mm.
And to be able to see out of the grill window at the back probably all the things that people were doing around, say, 6 o'clock in the evening, going into restaurants, going home, lining up to go into a theater, and this man's on his way to jail for probably 10, 15 years. And I've always felt that was a kind of last glimpse of ordinary life, everyday life.
Here we have a quiet little motel, tucked away off the main highway, and as you see, perfectly harmless looking, when in fact, it has now become known as the scene of the crime.
You've said that Psycho is essentially humorous, but its point of view and the moral tone is rather serious, isn't it?
Well, when I say humorous, it's my humor that makes me able to tackle the outrageousness of it.
Your main point in making that film was to make a horror film, wasn't it?
Yeah, make a horror film.
Scare the pants off people.
That's right. By the use of the visual.
Visual, yeah. Have you ever sit in an audience with the with,
never
with
an
audience?
It.
Never see a picture with an audience? Have you seen any of your films with audiences?
Not many. I saw North by Northwest at Chicago once. That's about the one I've seen.
Really? But don't you miss hearing them scream?
No.
You know they're going to anyway.
I can hear them when I'm making the picture.
Oh, that's wonderful. In Psycho, more than in any other film, don't you really direct the audience rather than the actors?
Yeah, definitely. All designed in every possible way for an audience. In other words, you're playing with the audience then. Mm. That's why the first scene of the murder in the bathroom is so violent, because as the film proceeds, there's less violence as it goes up.
Mm.
You know, the murder of the detective is quite swift.
Yes, yeah, it's not
one stroke, you see. And then as you go further on, you merely get the rush into the cellar and a grab. Now, if one hadn't had that terribly violent first murder, one would have had to introduce more violence later on to scare the audience more. But that laid itself into their minds so strongly that one didn't have to do much more. That was the whole point of it.
Yes. This was all designed to make the audience completely
helpless.
Sure.
Yeah. Strangely enough, the audience only used the actors to carry their minds through. In other words, I don't think in Psycho there's any identification
with the characters.
With the characters at all. Because A, there isn't time to develop them and there was no need to. But nevertheless, you know, the audience go through these paroxysms in Psycho without consciousness of Vera Miles or John Gavin. They don't exist as actors at all.
Or as people.
Or as people. They're just ciphers that lead the audience through that final part of the picture.
That's interesting.
Yes, it's
and it
an
was
interesting...
quite purposeful, wasn't it?
Oh, yes. Well, you know, nobody ever mentions that they were ever in the picture. It's rather sad for them, you know.
It's true, isn't it? Yeah.
But it's absolutely true.
It's either Janet Leigh or Anthony Perkins that they mention. Nobody ever really talks about
right.
it. Right. The whole point was to kill off the star.
Certainly it was. That's just shock.
Well, that's marvelous because you took advantage of not only of the audience's knowledge, pre-knowledge, that you can't kill off a star.
And not only that, don't forget, this is one of the basic reasons for making the audience go in from the beginning. You remember I was telling you yesterday at some point that you cannot have blurred thinking in suspense.
Mm-hmm.
Everything must be crystal clear in the minds of the audience.
Yeah.
So that they only have one emotion, is to be suspended or absorbed. They mustn't say, who's that, what is that, what, I don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
That must not go. Therefore, killing off Janet Leigh, they would have seen the advertising, the stills, and so forth. If they'd have gone halfway through the picture, they'd say, well, when's Janet Leigh coming on?
Mm-hmm.
You see? And the rest of the picture, they would have been bewildered. They would have said, well, I don't understand, where's Janet Leigh?
Mm-hmm.
And not until they went round a second time, you know, would they have found out. Well, this was, to me, shocking way to let an audience think.
Mother, oh God, mother, blood, blood.
Do you still feel that is one of your favorite films, or?
Yeah, it's favorite for me because of the use of pure cinema to cause an audience to emote.
Mm.
It wasn't done by words. It was done by visual means.
How would you define pure cinema?
Pure cinema is complementary pieces of film put together like notes of music make a melody, you know. For example, in Rear Window, where Jimmy Stewart is thrown out of the window at the end. I just photographed that with feet, legs, arms, heads, completely montaged. I also photographed it from a distance, a complete action. There was no comparison between the two. There never is.
Oh, Lisa, sweetie, if anything had happened to you.
Shut up,
I'm all right. Gee, I'm proud of you. You done enough for a search warrant now?
Oh, yeah, sure.
And the other, of course, is the juxtaposition of imagery relating to the mind of the individual. You can have a man look, you can have him see something, you have him react to it. Mm-hmm. You can make him react in various ways. You see, you can make him look at one thing, look at another. Without him speaking, you can show his mind at work, comparing things. Mm. Any way you look, there's a complete freedom.
And it has absolutely nothing to do with acting, does it?
No, not really. No. No, that's another thing. No. The it's limitless, I would say, the power of cutting and showing the various images, the assembly of them.
We'll be right back after this break.
Isn't Rear Window your major comment on voyeurism?
How do you mean?
Well, I mean, here's this man who's actually a voyeur. And, of course, he pops up again in Psycho. I mean, Perkins in a sense of voyeur. But the reason I start that question is because somebody said recently in an article about the film, they think it's a very good film, and they call it they call it Hitchcock's Testament movie. What they mean by that was, explaining it, and he said, a Testament movie is where the filmmaker makes his comment on what he thinks cinema is. So Rear Window would be considered your testament movie because, in a sense, cinema is a form of voyeurism because we are looking in, eavesdropping
sure.
on people.
Sure.
So would you agree with that
in terms
of Rear Window?
Yes, sure. I always remember Le Jeune of The Observer called it a horrible film because a man was looking in windows, you know. I thought it was a crappy remark because who cares, you know, about that kind of thing because everybody is it's a known fact, you know, that providing you don't make it too vulgar, you know.
But people aren't.
Keep it to a point of curiosity. People don't care who you are, cannot resist it.
In that film, we're on Stewart's side all the way through the picture because basically you have made us, the audience, peeping Toms too.
Sure, definitely. Yeah.
But isn't there something rather pathetic about and rather sympathetic about Burr's, the murderer's confrontation at the end, and Stewart doesn't even answer him or anything.
He can't, you know, the poor man. You know, says why it's the climax of the peeping Tomism, isn't it?
Yes.
Really.
Why did you do it?
If you hadn't been a peeping Tom, I'd have gotten away with it.
Yeah. But at that point in the film, one really, for the first time, one really says to oneself, you know, well, Stewart's a bit of a bastard. Because you feel a great deal of sympathy for Burr there. He comes in and says, why'd you do that? And then Stewart doesn't even answer him.
They can't. What can he say?
What can he say? It's true. He's really caught in the sense that he's caught with his pants down for the first time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Isn't
caught with his plaster down.
What is it you want? A lot of money? I don't have any money. Say something. Say something. Tell me what you want. Can you get me that ring back?
No.
Tell her to bring it back.
I can't. The police have it by now.
How do you work? What's your technique of working with actors?
I don't direct them. I talk to them and explain to them what the scene is, what its purpose is, and why they are doing certain things, because they relate to the story, not to the scene. The whole scene relates to the story, but that little look does this for the story.
I see. And of all the actors you've worked with, who would you say was the most fit in best with the technique that you use?
Jimmy will give it to you. Carey, anybody with a mobile face, you see. As I try to explain to that girl, Kim Novak, I said, you've got a lot of expressions in your face. Don't want any of them. I only want on your face what we want to tell to the audience, what you're thinking.
Scotty, why are we here?
I told you. I have to go back into the past once more, just once more, for the last time.
Would you agree that Vertigo is the your ultimate statement on illusion versus reality?
Oh, yes. I think Vertigo was had a tremendous amount in it. I think largely unappreciated in this country.
In Vertigo, color plays a more important part than in any of your other pictures, doesn't it?
Yes, it is.
It was composed very carefully for the color.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
How did you get the idea for that scene in the bookshop when it gets darker and darker, you know?
Yes.
How did that develop?
Well, I think it was the mood of the narration, you know, seemed to me to warrant dusk falling around that time.
It also gave it such a dreamlike.
Yeah, but don't forget, I want to explain this to you. In the early part, which is purely in the mind of Stuart, when he's watching this girl go from place to place, which he's really faking, you know, behaving like a woman of the past, in order to get this slightly subtle quality of a dreamlike nature, although it was bright sunshine, I had the film shot through a fog filter.
Oh, really?
If you're doing in black and white pictures, you know, and you're doing a fog scene, you can put a filter over the camera, which is called a fog filter.
So that you get the illusion of fog without having to have a real fog.
Right.
Mm.
But I put fog over a bright scene of bright sunshine, and it had another effect.
It had kind of a dreamlike
effect. Yeah, that was done deliberately.
Say, will you tell me something? That lady sitting in there, who's the woman in the painting she's looking at?
Oh, that's Carlotta. You find it in the catalog. Portrait of Carlotta.
May I have this?
Yes.
Thank you.
Of all the pictures you've made, which are your is your most favorite, and why?
I think Shadow of a Doubt is one, because of the character nature of the blending of character and thriller at the same time. Yes. Very hard to do.
Yes.
You see, you don't.
You've done it again
time.
With the birds, really.
The birds. It's the next nearest to it, and ironically enough, the two pictures were made within 20 miles of each other.
Yes.
The locale.
Santa Rosa and.
And I got Bodega Bay from being at Santa Rosa. I come to know it.
How did you come to choose the birds as a vehicle?
I felt that after Psycho, they would expect something to top it.
Mm.
Before going off at a tangent, you see.
To something else, yeah.
To something else. I think I had to top that.
How do you do? My name is Alfred Hitchcock, and I would like to tell you about my forthcoming lecture. It is about the birds and their age-long relationship with man. It will be seen in theaters like this across the country.
Wasn't there something you said to me about that there was... 300 trick shots, what was it?
Yes, there were 371 trick shots.
And you said in an interview that this is about the most difficult picture you ever made.
No question about it. Technically, yes, by far. I would say Cleopatra or Ben-Hur is nothing. It's just quantities of people and scenery.
Mm.
Gulls flying in the middle of the town, smashing into the telephone booth. Look what they do. Look at the way the crows run, chase the children down the street. Dive all around them. Little boys try to protect themselves, covered in birds behind the telegraph pole, by the high power line pole. If you examine each little piece of film in that bird chase, by the shots when the children are running with their backs to us and they land on the backs of the children, you know, it took days to organize those birds on the hood of the car and fly away from it at the end before the girl,
really?
After she's blown the horn. Oh, they all had to be trained for that. See, don't forget, it's a very important thing, Peter, about the birds. I never raised the point, can it be done?
Because at the outset, you mean?
Would never have been made. Any technician would have told you impossible. So I said, you know, I didn't even raise the point. Here's what we're going to do. Oh, we haven't figured out how to do that. I said, why don't you do it this way, that way? Well, we've tried that. Well, then try something else. It had to be done. It was, and this is an important thing which nobody will ever realize, that had the pioneering technical work on it not been attempted, the film definitely would not have been made. It really wouldn't.
Well, you'll never cease to amaze me. Everybody says that you never look through the viewfinder,
never
look through the camera. How do you know that? How do you know then? How can you be sure that what they're getting for you is what you want? Because you rely on the cameraman to.
Because he knows me well enough to know what I want, mm-hmm. And when in doubt, draw a rectangle and draw it out for him. You see, there's a. The point is that you are in, first of all, a two-dimensional medium. Mustn't forget that.
Mm-hmm.
You have a rectangle, oblong rectangle to fill. Fill it. Compose it. Mm-hmm. I don't have to look through a camera for that.
You never do, do you?
What's the point, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like taking a still, like a newspaper man takes a still and trims it down to its essentials.
Well, it's not easy. I don't think most directors do it.
I know they don't, but it's second nature to me.
Yes, it becomes like, but you never did, even from the beginning, did you?
No, hardly. You see, when I'm on a set, I'm not on a set. If I'm looking at acting, or looking at the scene, the way it's played, or where they are, I'm looking at a screen. In other words, I do not follow the geography of a set. I follow the geography of the screen.
I understand.
I can only think of the screen. I do not think. See, most of these directors say, well, he's got to come in that door, therefore he's got to walk from there to there, you see. So they jump back and show him walking from there to there, which is as dull as hell. Mm. And not only that, it makes the shot itself so empty and so loose and so letting down that I say, well, if he's still in a mood, whatever his mood is, take him across in a close-up.
Mm.
But keep the mood on the screen. We're not interested in distance. I don't care he's got to go across the room. What's the state of mind?
Yeah.
Take him in close up over to the door. Mm. You can only think of the screen. You cannot think of the set where you are in a studio. Nothing of that.
So all you see is this?
All I see is the rectangle.
Yeah.
And what's on it?
I consider North by Northwest as the ultimate and perhaps your final word on the kind of chase film you began with, 39 Steps.
It is. That was the American 39 Steps.
Yeah.
Thought of it for a long time. When can I do a chase in America, you know? Only one sequence missing from that.
Which is?
The assembly line in Detroit. Never got that in.
You wanted to do that?
Yeah. You know, I ever tell you about that?
No.
Oh yes, I tried hard to get it in. I couldn't. I wanted one of the scenes, the dialogue of two men. Don't know which you mean. Walking along an assembly line, and behind them is a car being assembled. Starts with a bare frame, and gets better and better. They're having this scene. Should relate a little bit to automobiles or to whatever part of the story we're dealing with. And it goes on, and it gets better. Loose shots, see, so you see everything clearly,
mm-hmm.
with their dialogue in front. And finally, you see, they load up with gas. They do it, they drive them off, you know, the assembly. Have you ever seen an assembly line?
No.
They drive it off at the end, you know.
Really?
All electrical systems. Oh,
put
yeah, they rev it
somebody
up.
Somebody gets in, drives it off.
They put gas in, and the man drives it off. Well, I want to see this. I wanted to see the car finally come up, and it pulled off the line, and they open the door and look in. The dead body falls out. I have a brand new car.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Never got it.
Couldn't figure out how to put it in.
No.
Of course, it was criticized, as self-parody. But no, this was purposeful self-parody in a sense, wasn't it?
That's not. That was that guy on the New Yorker.
Yeah.
Where they said Hitchcock was being unconsciously funny.
Well, of course, one of the funniest pictures you've made on purpose.
Of course it was. It was stupid. I don't know why these people are so stupid. Is that
Well, they must think that you're stupid. They must think you're stupid because how could you make a picture like that? You couldn't be serious about it, certainly.
Of course not. It's a fantasy. It's a fairy story. All of it.
Hot day.
Seen worse.
Are you supposed to be meeting someone here?
Waiting for the bus. Due any minute.
Oh.
That's funny.
What?
That plane's dusting crops where there ain't no crops.
Was any of the plane seen process, or was most of it shot the way it really
All
was?
Shot the way you saw it.
Really?
Yes. No process of any kind.
Mm. Carrie told me that you had a real plane for that sequence in North by Northwest.
Oh, yes.
And it was right behind him. He said he didn't know what was going to happen. He said he took his orders from you. Duck, and he ducked.
That's right.
So if he hadn't ducked, he would have had
it. What do you mean? We all had to duck on the camera as well when he came over. Because we were on a dolly when he ran. It dived on him and us as well. Skim the top of the camera.
Well, I know what he means now when he takes his life in his hands when he makes a picture with you.
One shot I couldn't get into that one. Oh, I was dying to get it in. Cary Grant hiding up Lincoln's nostril.
Yes, having a sneezing fit.
And Cary has a sneezing fit.
You told me that. That's marvelous. Well, you really couldn't shoot on Mount Rushmore.
Wouldn't let us know. No. Shot all around it, but not on it. Mm. Mustn't touch the shrine of democracy, they said.
Somebody said that Stewart in Rear Window, Kelly in To Catch a Thief, and Teresa Wright in Shadow of a Doubt, and Doris Day in Man Who Knew Too Much, and even, in a sense, Cary Grant in North by Northwest, all of them make some statement about nothing ever happening to them. And somebody said that was your comment on the virtues of the simple life. What do you think of that?
I think there's a lot to be said for that. Don't forget, you have to remember this. Let's look at me psychologically. Do you want this on the record or off the record?
Whatever, it's up to you.
Don't type it then.
All right.
Cut for a minute, would you? Will you hold it? Hold the roll.
I don't think he hears you. He fell asleep.
Did you hear me call out, hold the roll?
Can you hold the roll for a second?
If you've been enjoying The Plot Thickens, why not give us a rating or review? And tell a friend about us, too. We really appreciate it. See you next time.